Don't major in engineering? I think that's the wrong attitude. So in this video, we're talking about this video that may have misled you, and also five things that I don't agree with within it, lessons from that. And I'm also gonna give you a playbook of how to actually choose the right major for you. And we're starting right now. Hey, 1% Nation, I'm Jake Voorhees, and welcome back to the 1% Engineer Show, where we empower young engineers to rise to the top 1% of their career. So if this is you, make sure you hit the notification bell and subscribe. If you want the 1% Engineer Kit, access to the Discord server, and a link to the new IG page, find the links in the description. What type of engineer do you want to be? Comment below. I want to say really quickly that this video is just a disagreement with the content in this video. It's not a personal attack. I've been on the Creator Show twice, and we talked on the phone a month ago or so, but the communities that we share, 1% Engineer and his community, is just very different, and they've gone in different directions. And I don't like that this video has so many views. It's a little misleading. I don't agree with many things in it. And that's actually what this video is the top five takeaways that you can learn, things that were misleading from this video. And then finally, I'll give you a playbook, the way to actually choose the right engineering major, because I think it's a great industry that's not going away. And I think you should be an engineer if you are already interested in it, and if you have been considering in the future. And content like this just makes people scared, and I think sends them down the wrong path. So I'm making this video in order to help you guys the most. This video begins with a comment made by a chemical engineer, and the comment summary is this: as a 2016 graduate from a state school in California and majored in chemical engineering, we know that there's only 34,000 chemical engineers employed in America today, which is 10 times less than civil, 10 times less than mechanical. So that's already the first issue, guys. The student said they got a 3.5 GPA. That's really good. 3.33 is usually what you need to make Dean's List. And anything above 3.0 is considered pretty good. Especially if you can get 3.5 in engineering, woo, you're in good shape. You can see the tone of this comment, and I empathize with this engineer because it seems like they've lost hope. They talk about how they've looked for a year, and it's a really sad message. I get a lot of these emails and comments, and people just feel lost. They feel stuck. They don't know what to do next. You can tell that this engineer has that attitude. And this is the problem, guys. This is lesson number one. For what I don't agree with in this video is it doesn't matter what your GPA is. GPA doesn't matter. A 3.5 with no experience and no connections, even more important, no relationships, no networking, no connections to jobs, no ties to the industry, you will not be successful. Time after time after time, I've heard of engineers going to Stanford and Berkeley and Ivy League schools. They didn't network. They didn't go to career fairs. They didn't get internships. They thought that just a degree and a good enough GPA is going to make them successful. And this comment alone is an example of that. That's not really talked about in this video, is that's not the formula to success. And in a way, this exact problem points that out. It's not going to carry you into an opportunity. And then the video continues to talk about his journey with engineering and what his colleagues and his classmates were doing. And originally, Matt actually majored in psychology. So I guess he has two degrees, a psychology degree and a mechanical engineering degree. But what he says is that most of his classmates went on to grad school. They went on to become social workers, maybe work in the nonprofit space. Lesson number two is coming here, guys, but he almost mocks them. He almost laughs at them, saying, oh, maybe they find it fulfilling, maybe it makes them happy. But he insinuates that chasing impact and having a difference in the world and helping people, even if it makes a little less money, is not the path. And I actually decisively disagree with this, because what you will find if you study rich people, if you study successful people, if you study celebrities, once they have all the money, the influence, and the power, actually they don't want any of that. They realize that it doesn't lead them to happiness. It doesn't lead them to fulfillment. They don't feel any different. They just feel the same. Do some research, guys. Story after story after story is laid down of people finding money, finding wealth, and then discovering this, and they still feel empty. They still feel this void because they haven't discovered the key to happiness. And to me, the key to happiness, as I turn 33 in 4 days, what I've learned in my 33 years, maybe about one third of a human life, is that the Japanese term for what is ikigai is one of the best summaries for it. Is, why did you wake up today? What is the point of your life? Don't just live this life. Don't just exist, but thrive in this life. What difference are you making? Who are you helping? How are you leaving an impression on this world? That's what makes people happy. They wake up and they feel good about being a part of a mission, have purpose, have vision, have passion for making an impact. This is actually the path to pure happiness. And content online that teaches you the wrong thing and omits this and even mocks it and laughs at it is just not the way, guys. So that's lesson number two, is you have to find passion and fulfillment in your work. And that's just the reality, guys. So many people think that money will make them happy. It's not true. After the content mocks social workers and people who have an actual fulfilling career, he talks about how before he made the decision to get a second degree in mechanical engineering, he reflected on his psychology degree and he says this, "I realized that I didn't know anything. I realized that I didn't learn anything from my degree." And that's lesson number two, is that it's not about what you know. You actually don't learn anything that's significant in university. University teaches you how to think, teaches you how to solve problems, teaches you how to work in sophisticated engineering teams, and teaches you how to work with a greater, bigger engineer and learn from them, which is a professor. They're not the greatest at teaching, but it's not what you know. University teaches you how to think. I didn't use most of the stuff that I learned in my engineering degree in the first year, the second year, the fifth year of my job, but it got me ready. I knew how to strategize, how to break problems down, how to communicate them. So again, guys, it's not about what you know leaving engineering. It's far more about who you are, what you want, being on a quest to actually become a certain type of engineer and having people help you achieve that. And far more, it's about who you know than what you know. I make so much content about this, guys. 80% of all jobs in America never go advertised because they want a referral. They want somebody in their office to say, "Hey, I have a friend of a friend who can give me a trusted referral and get you a job." I have never applied to jobs, guys, with success. I've only gotten all of my opportunities through somebody that I knew. That's just the reality. So it's not about what you know. If you feel like you haven't learned anything, or if you feel like you're not gonna ever use that Calc 2 or that Calc 3 outside of university, you probably won't. I never used anything outside of Calculus 2. From my degree, but I had to take the class twice because I didn't do great in it. And even though it's the only course that I took two times at university, it doesn't matter what you know. It doesn't matter what you know, it's who you know and who you are. That's lesson number three. There's a section in this video too that points out a couple Bureau of Labor Statistics aspects and talks about how they're all declining. It's just not realistic. And it suggests that this isn't an investable career. It's not a good avenue. If you look at the top 25 highest paid salaries based on degree, 23 of them are in STEM, and 14 of them have the word engineering in the title, guys. So more than half of the highest paid degrees are engineering degrees. It is a good career. It's not going away. It is going to grow. Is it competitive? Yes. You got to make sure you choose the right one. We'll talk about this at the end of the video. It's just the wrong message for you to worry about becoming an engineer and be concerned about this. You shouldn't worry. You're fine. You're going to be fine. 1% Nation, you are fine. And then the video continues to talk about how he got a psychology degree, quit that avenue, went into mechanical engineering, got that degree, actually quit that too, and then started to pursue web development and software engineering. That's okay, but in a way decided to abandon mechanical engineering and move on to the next thing. And then what happened was he decided that, oh, I don't really like that much either, and then started going to YouTube. And the lesson here is that, guys, if you don't get success right away, you can't just move on. Matt probably would have been happy and successful and would have been a good psychologist or psychology career person. He could have an awesome channel called Psychology Truth or something like that. But the reality here is that if you just pivot and move on and move to the next thing, you're missing out on a big aspect of life. And that's lesson number four, which is the 10,000 hour rule. It takes 10,000 hours on average to become an expert at something, to be good at something, to be a pro at something. And if you give up at the early days of that grind, 10,000 hours is 2,000 hours a year, which is about a 40-hour work week all year. We work about 2,000 hours a year for 5 years. 10,000 hours is 5 years of doing something, and then you're good at it. Then you know something. Then you can start to see that, like, oh, actually, this is something I can do for a little bit longer. It takes time. There's the dip. You have to get through some of that pain and some of that learning curve before things get interesting. And I see so many engineers, they get into the first semester, the first year, the first 6 months of their career, an internship right away, and they've already decided that they don't like it and they quit. And the reality is that you can't quit. You have to persist. You have to persevere. This is the path to success. In fact, if you look at all the biggest, most successful people and companies, actually they work. weren't special. They weren't different. They didn't do anything innovative. They just didn't quit. Kentucky Fried Chicken, over 1,000 recipes. Or Thomas Edison and the light bulb, over 3,000 designs for a light bulb. Imagine if he had quit at 2,999, right? You're a big failure. The difference between success and failure is exclusively that you didn't quit. And I think that's quite a paramount lesson for this video, as opposed to the message in the other video that we're reviewing here, guys, because if you quit, you fail. If you keep going, you always win. You always win. And so as he continues to talk about switching from thing to thing to thing to thing, and then finally sort of saying that he didn't want to do web development either, he went into entrepreneurship and became a YouTuber, and kind of insinuates that you can be an entrepreneur just like me if you do this coding bootcamp. It's really a promo. What this video really is an ad for the coding bootcamp that he's promoting. He says it in the video that he was able to go to this coding bootcamp this weekend, this week, whatever it was, for free to make this video. And it's a pretty good exchange because the coding bootcamp costs anywhere between $5,000 to $10,000. It's not cheap. And he doesn't really say that. But what's happening here, guys, lesson number five is that you have to establish expectations. And that's why the community, if you read through the comments, there's a little bit of turmoil in the response, because people are okay with waiting. People are okay with tough love. People are okay with news that isn't sugar-coated, but they want the truth. They want to know what to expect. And so what happened here in this video is that you showed up with the intent to learn more about which majors to avoid and how to choose the right engineering major. But then what you get in this video is basically a promotional piece of content for you to be a web developer, okay? For you to go to this coding bootcamp and pay them money, which is a lot of money because they paid me to make this video. It's called a bait and switch tactic, guys. You came in the door thinking that you were gonna get a haircut and they tried to sell you something else. You went into the car dealership with the intent on just browsing, and then they tried to sell you the limo, right? This is what it is. This is a big life lesson, guys, is you gotta do what you said you were gonna do. You can't switch it up on people. They don't like that. They feel duped. Whenever people feel like they were tricked or feel like they were deceived or feel like you're not absolutely genuine and authentic, people can sense it. We have really good BS meters. And in situations like this, I think they start to go off the charts, because I don't think 1% Nation that you would have had a problem with this being a paid sponsorship ad or just being more genuine and being more honest and upfront about what's really going on. The video should be called a promotion or an ad or why you should go to a coding bootcamp. That should be the title of the video. And that's why that's lesson number five, is to establish the right expectations and then meet those expectations. So those are the top five lessons and takeaways and things that I don't agree with that video. So now, what did you guys come here for? It is a playbook to actually choose the right major. So if you look at the spreadsheet that I built, guys, it shows the amount of engineers that are employed within different types of engineering categories, and then how many graduates are being churned out each year. And so if you take a look at this, you will see very clearly that that's the reason why this chemical engineer can't get a job, is because, first of all, you didn't get any internships, you didn't network, but you picked a very narrow type of engineering. So what you guys got to do is choose one of the big four, okay? Be a mechanical engineer, be a civil engineer, be an electrical engineer, or go into software development, software engineering. Those are the big four. There are 1.3 million people employed within software development. Not all of them are engineers who make software instead of working with software. Software engineering is a branch of computer science, guys. There's over 300,000 civil engineers, over 300,000 mechanical, and also electrical. There's a million engineers in those three alone. Industrial engineering is another industry that should be looked at. There's 280,000 people employed in that. So the first tip is, don't choose something niche. I don't really agree with becoming an aerospace engineer and choosing that as a degree when you could do mechanical engineering and then do internships and take tech electives in aerospace engineering instead of product engineering or instead of automotive engineering, guys. But you have more range and more flexibility instead of pigeonholing yourself, okay? Tip number two to actually choosing the right engineering major is you have to go out and talk to people who have the job that you think you want, okay? So many students, they choose an engineering major because they think it can lead them to this type of career, but they don't really know. They didn't go out there and do the research. They didn't talk to people. They didn't do what they call our informational interviews, where you find somebody who is at the helm of the role that you think you want, and you interview them. You ask them questions. You ask them, do you like your job? Do you like what you do? What do you do every day? This is what you need to do for success. You have to conduct informational interviews, guys. And then tip number three for choosing the right engineering major is you have to be self-aware. You have to look at yourself. How do you spend your time? What content do you absorb? What books do you read? What YouTube channels do you watch? What are you excited about? What do you talk about? What are you interested in? That is what you have to chase. You have to kind of have this vision for where your interests are and what you're passionate about and chase that, right? You want that to be a part of your career. That Japanese ikigai, you wake up every day and you work on this engineering problem. You work on solving a challenge in the world that can change the face of the earth, that can change the environment, that can change our infrastructure, that can really help human societies and community. That's what people want. So those are the top three, guys, okay? Choose one of the bigger core types of engineering. Don't be a biomedical engineer. Be a mechanical engineer. And then take classes in biomedical or get an internship in biomedical engineering and see if you like it. Because if you major in biomedical engineering or aerospace engineering, right, and then you get on the job and you don't like it, what are you going to do now? It's a little bit harder to back up and reset because you've already gone down the rabbit hole, okay? So choose a broader type of engineer. Do informational interviews and network, okay? It's about who you know. For all the jobs, opportunities, grad school assignments, and things that I was able to achieve, I never got them by applying. It's the people that I knew. So find the people who you think have the job that you want to have. Talk to 10, okay? Find 10 of them. And then finally, be self-aware. Look in the mirror. What are your passions? What are your interests? That's the playbook to choosing the right engineering major. So I hope you enjoyed that video, guys. I've never criticized another video or given constructive criticism on a piece of content on the internet ever before. So this is going to be interesting. Again, I want to affirm that this is not a personal attack or personal criticism. I just don't agree with some of the positions and some of the actions in that video, and I really think it's important for you guys who probably watch that channel as well to think about and look at and know for the future so that you can be a real 1% engineer. Because if you follow that video, you might not ever actually become an engineer. So thanks again for watching the 1% Engineer Show. If you're a young engineer and you want to rise to the top 1% of your career, then make sure you turn on the notification bell and subscribe. Check out the 1% Engineer Kit below. Thanks again, guys. What was the most compelling lesson that you found in this video? Comment below. See you again in another video. Bye-bye. Bye.